workshop of the Susquehanna County Planning Commission will come to order. Number one, are we, he's not...
Is he here? Pat's still there? No, okay.
So we, is he...
Where's Todd?
So he's Susquehanna Transfer?
Right.
Okay, we'll go to number two, Susquehanna Transfer Facility, a commercial development in Bridgewater Township, a sketch plan presentation by Fox Engineering.
Okay, I've got some preliminary plans here, and I can, these are... Proposed development, Bobby, you know, let us know here. Take place over on Ellsworth Drive. And, you know... Okay, so to orient you, the road on the left, coming into the left side of the paper, that's an extension of Ellsworth Drive. And what you see here is, this is private road, private property. And this little detail down in the corner just is a match line to that that shows extending out to Ellsworth Drive, right about where the driveway goes up to the...
Where does it start to be a private road?
It starts to be a private road down here in the lower left corner. And this, you could see the proximity to the driveway.
Excuse me?
I have another drawing here that shows a bigger picture.
To the map, so that the LC can see.
Yep.
You have an extra one?
How are you?
We just started. Well, rippling down.
This is an existing...
We're doing number two.
I don't think they...
Okay.
They have access. So this, what's in front of Mr. Franks here is the, an overall of the existing site. The rest that you have is the proposed development, so there is a difference here. This one shows where the private property starts, right here next to where the road goes up to the county jail. So...
Recycling center is there.
So the jail's up above.
Private road starts back here.
So then the road past the Clem property is private, then, that little area?
Yeah, that's right.
Just that's where it starts, the beginning of this property?
Yeah, that's right. And I believe there's access to these properties owned by Mr. Lewis and Mr. Clem. They have access on this private road. So anyway, the overall long-term proposed development here, when I say long-term, I think eventually they're looking to get approval from the DEP to put in a solid waste transfer station. And that's what our proposed layout of the site would be. This property is currently owned by Diaz Family Limited Partnership, and Mr. Adam Diaz is involved, of course, with the proposed development, which is called Susquehanna Transfer. Now, on this plan, there's a small building here, which is adjacent to a proposed scale. That would be a scale house and an office. So there's two buildings here, a scale house and office, and the transfer building is also shown on here. So the first step in this development would be to install the office building, scale house, and then the larger building will be built at a later time. They are currently in the process of seeking approval from the DEP for the construction of the transfer, for the use of that transfer building for transfer of solid waste. So what I want to put before you is an idea of what we'd like it to look like. And we'd like to come back next month with a map that would be requesting approval for the, at a minimum, the office building. small building there and receive approval for that. And also, if you are somewhat inclined to approve the other building for use as a warehouse, and then we can, that building would have a specific use if you're willing to approve it as a warehouse. Then in the future, if and when this permit comes for the use of that facility as a solid waste transfer facility, we would come back to your commission here and ask for approval for that building to be used as a solid waste transfer facility with the permit in hand. So what do you think of that approach? Do you have any ideas as to what you think about that? As approving that building as just a plain old warehouse?
Would anything that we look at, does it make any difference what's in that building?
The use of it?
Yeah.
Well, see, we need, in order for them to operate the waste facility, we would need the DEP permit.
Because we need all applicable permits as we learned recently.
Okay.
So that's really the only reason we're going to come back to this.
Yeah, because we would need the DEP permit for them to. Now, I don't know what their plans are, but would it be possible to just show on a map the office and the scale now?
We could do that, sure.
And take this proposed building off.
I don't know if you'd want to do that, though.
Well, we'd like to get started on that, and we're not going to get approval for the whole thing. Let's go for that.
That's, like I said, that's the holdup there, that DEP permit.
Now, when I come back next month with this, would you want to see that building there in a gray shaded area as a potential phase two, or should we just not even show it? I can do it either way. We're focused on getting
future construction or something.
Show it as future construction, realizing that you're not going to approve it as such. But it's informative.
How many employees do they plan to have? Do you have any idea?
I don't know. Lauren, do you have an idea?
2 to 6.
Okay.
Basically, the trucks will come in, unload, and go underway.
Right.
Yeah, and then other smaller trucks will come in, unload the waste, and then larger trucks, it will be consolidated into larger trucks and taken to a landfill.
Oh, okay.
So a small truck might carry a couple of tons, 2 or 3 tons of material,
mm-hmm.
and then the larger trucks would carry maybe 15 or 20 tons.
So you're dumping the transfer building and then reload it right in the building.
Yeah. That's basically all it is collecting waste and putting a larger quantity onto a larger truck to drive it a further distance to reduce the amount of trucks on the road. So instead of every garbage truck carrying it from here all the way down to Taylor, take it down to South Montrose, put it inside, consolidate it into a larger truck, and take less larger trucks further down the road. There's not much more than that to it.
Is this basically for like household garbage?
It would be both for, that building would be split into two parts. Half of it would be for household, municipal type waste, and the other half would be geared towards industrial waste, which would be something like that would support the industrial activities in the area, like gas drilling, things like that they would have.
So tailings and that kind of stuff that gets collected now?
Yeah, there's certain things that are collected now. It's taking place right now out of those sites, and they just need a place to consolidate those materials and take them to the final destination. So this is just a holding facility. The materials will come in for a relatively short period of time and be put onto a truck and then taken out. So
So then as long, again, I'm looking at you for some guidance here, as long as I get the proper permits.
Yeah.
That's the end of our responsibility, right?
You're not approving the activity.
But they do, just making sure that what they do is not permitted and it's legal.
It's not zoning.
Yep, I know.
I was involved with preparing plans and some things for the submission of that permit to DEP. And they're looking at everything. They're looking at everything that you can imagine for this facility when they issue their permit. And it takes them, oh, probably a year or so to go through the process. So they're doing a very thorough job to make a decision as to whether or not they're willing to permit this site.
And transfer, just not that it's terribly important, but I'm curious, transfer facilities like this exist all over the state now?
They do.
In more urban areas, correct?
Yeah, they do. There's one up in Apple Lake in New York, and there's, we've looked at some, several other places around the state. This is commonly done. So it sounds like the feedback that I'm getting is, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'll submit another plan to you with this transfer building grayed out as future development with the scale and scale house there as something for you to review and hopefully approve next month. And then we can get started on putting that building and those utilities to that small building. So that's the approach that we're going to take.
Is that reasonable?
Yeah, I think so.
I'd like to ask a question when I can of him.
Go ahead.
I'd like to ask, why do you need a DEP permit? If it's mostly municipal garbage, do you need a permit because it might be radioactive because of cuttings?
A permit's needed for this type of activity. DEP is the one that comes up with these permits and why. So it's needed because DEP, there's a law in the books that says that a permit is needed.
For what, a transfer station specifically?
Yes.
And are all the other transfer stations in our state, do they all have DEP permits?
I can't speak for all of them, but that is what's expected for each one, and I believe that many of them do, if not all of them.
So are you concerned about the radiation and chemicals and the heavy metals that will be coming in with the cuttings that will be landing in the building there as you transfer them?
We don't know. We don't know it. The
building will be designed and operated in conformance with the rules and regulations of DEP. And so they're aware of what types of things take place in those buildings.
And what's your name? You are Fox Engineering?
My name is Todd Schmidt.
Todd Schmidt?
Yep.
Can I ask a question also? Has it been discharge, say, if you wash trucks or anything like that, any kind of drainage?
There will be no discharge.
Okay, since we've got about...
No discharge from municipal waste? How is that possible?
Thanks, Don.
How is it possible that there's no discharge from municipal waste?
Excuse me.
My garbage can always has water in it.
It's because you put it out in the rain.
No, it's not. No, it's because organic things deteriorate.
Yeah, right.
Okay, we're going to move on to number four. Mineral Point Energy Facility, IMG, Industrial Development in Oakland Township, requesting conditional preliminary approval.
There were three here. Two. Okay. Actually, we have small. Actually, there's three. Do you want to talk about it?
Yeah, if you would like to stay.
Yeah, if you can, by the sound of
it. I'm Quentin Wood with McTish Conklin Associates. I am working with the Federal Point on the development of this facility. This is John Tegu. He's with IMG. He's representing IMG and also Mineral Point as well.
Speak up just a little bit, please.
Sure. So what you have in front of you is an electric generation facility. The electric is generated from natural gas, which is coming into the site from the local wells and gathering lines.
Sure, I can just kind of give you an overview. So we currently have an operating facility in Auburn Township. It's on the same premise. These are five small GE Genbacher natural gas fired reciprocating engines, similar technology to what you'd have in an oil or kerosene generator or even a gasoline generator, just reciprocating engines that's then converted to electricity. The plan is to source gas from the DTE Bluestone gathering system and pipeline, and then convert to approximately 20 megawatts of energy and inject that into the local grid via PJM interconnection. What's different about this plant compared to the one we did in Auburn Township in Susquehanna County is that we were contemplating having compartmentalized engines. So instead of having all the engines inside of one large building, each individual engine is housed within steel containers, completely contained, and then there'll be a central control room and tank room off to the side, as well as the typical auxiliary structures, such as a generator step up, which gets the voltage up so we can send it out to the grid, and then the gas conditioning skid, which treats the natural gas to a point it's ready to burn pressure and temperature wise. This application, the land development part of it is for, our subdivision is about a 3-acre parcel. What's smaller than that is the actual pad that the buildings will sit on, and a driveway leading up to the building. The site will be accessed through a shared road agreement from the underlying landowners, and then Southwestern and DTE also use the main driveway up to the facility. It's very close to an existing DTE compressor station, and as well as Endless Mountain Stone's quarry up on top of the hill.
So this in yellow is the key. That's the 3 acres.
The hardest rendition. That's my rendition.
How far is it from the compressor station, the DTE? What would you say? How many feet?
I couldn't tell you the exact number. I don't know if we have it cited on our plans. It's
a bit over 1,000 feet.
What's the name of the existing?
Yeah, what's the name of, which one is it, the DT?
I don't have that information.
So DTE, CDP something, I forget.
Yeah, right.
It's
they
got the Slinger, right? There's the landowner.
The yellow is the 3 acres.
Is that true? Well, I thought there was a square around the subdivision site. Yes,
and then a little irregular.
Right, so the staging area and the line, black line around the outside, which would be the 3 acres. The yellow is the graded portion.
Is this going to be bigger than the one in Harvard Valley, Jeff? Same flow lines?
Right, same export, yeah.
Six separate.
Same five engines, correct.
You've done a good job down there. Yeah.
Well, thank you. We trying to stay true to what we proposed and operating a tight ship. And we appreciate that. We've worked very hard.
Can I ask a question? Will this be burning like raw gas, or is it refined already? What do you refine it?
It's coming out of, it will be on the compressed side of the facility. So it's compressed and then discharged, and then it'll be dry. I mean, the gas that's coming out of the ground is already pretty dry in the area, so we won't have to.
No, it's not that dry. Is it coming from a compressor station that's already been refined? But I'd call it compressor stations refineries rather than compressor stations. They have compressors, but actually refineries. So is it refined gas you're using, or raw gas from the wells?
I don't think I could speak to that precisely.
Wow, okay.
Are you planning to have a dehydrator and condensate tank on your facility?
I don't have the gas analysis on the gas that will be sourced there and whether or not it will require additional dehydration or not.
You don't know very much, do you?
You know, can I speak for a second? We allow you to ask a lot of questions that have nothing to do with why we're here tonight, so please don't insult.
I apologize.
Yes, I apologize. You should apologize.
I did.
The venting is upward, the exhaust pipes.
Correct. The exhaust pipes will be behind each individual station, and they will be similar to the height that is used there.
Yeah.
They're baffled and up.
Your seat is there.
You may be looking at...
Five engines.
Oh, no, okay, so six on that configuration.
Really?
Oh, yeah, that's a different drawing.
Oh.
That has five, this one has six.
Oh, we're on this.
There's six on that.
There's six, okay. That's what I had in the memo. I thought you had a comment there.
Does anybody on the planning commission have any other questions?
So what DEP permits are required?
From the civil side, we needed a NPDS.
Right, got that.
We also need a DEP, a general permit.
General permit.
Which will be going with the electric line.
Okay.
And then we have a non-building sewage waiver.
Right.
That we need to acquire as well.
And the air quality permit?
That will be needed for the emission, yes.
Right.
So, yeah.
It's a minor source air permit as well.
Is that what you call it? Okay. And that comes from the DEP?
Correct.
Okay. Just want to make sure that we're saying the same thing. We're calling it, I called it an air quality permit. I want to make sure that was, you know, we don't want to ask for something that you're not...
Right, right. It's a DEP issued minor air emission source.
Okay.
What's the horsepower of the engine? I'm sorry.
We measure it in megawatts, you know, as opposed to the horsepower. I don't know the horsepower off the top of my head, but each engine is approximately 4 megawatts of electrical energy.
So it's about 20.
Is each engine individually permitted for air quality, or is it the cumulative of the site?
The plant as a whole.
I'm surprised that's a...
It's a total.
Yeah, you can access it through Great Bend, but it's in the...
Right.
The lot is an open.
Right. But you cannot agree that counts.
And this is similar to the Auburn station in that it's an on-demand. It won't necessarily run all the time?
Correct. People ask us if we're a peak or a base load plant, and we generally fall somewhere in between. We sell into PJM markets, a number of different markets. Most of them are dispatched on a either day ahead or real time basis. I'd say over the course of the year, we probably average about 50 to 70% of the time that we're running.
Is there a person there that flips a switch or something?
No, so the plants are remotely operated from, and this will be from our operations center in Tuckhannock. Additionally, we have technicians that are on site daily.
When John and I went out to see the one in Auburn, there was a fellow there, and he said he, you know, flips the switch basically when he gets the call.
The dispatching comes in through the operations center in Tuckhannock, and then it's all done.
But they can do it remotely then?
Yes, they can do it. Yeah, there are controls in the actual controller, so you could physically turn it off or disconnect. We can power down there or up there, but they are remotely operated.
He did tell us that it could be operated from
Now, why do you need a waiver for the sewer part? Is there going to be no bathrooms at this facility?
Correct.
And then what are people supposed to do who work there?
The technicians only work there as they come out. They don't work from that location. They come out occasionally as needed during the day.
So they're only there for short periods? They don't have to go to the bathroom?
They can have a porta potty when they're working.
Right, so during construction, there would be porta potties, or something that the contractor would set up.
But they don't allow porta potties permanently, right? Isn't there a zoning of some kind?
Right, so during construction.
Only during construction. So after that, there's no porta potties.
Correct.
So it's just the field?
They're good managers of their time.
Okay, is Eugene or Patricia Fraser here?
We're here on their behalf.
Oh, good.
Oh, okay. It's a one-lot major subdivision in Forest Lake Township. They're requesting conditional preliminary and final approval.
Can I ask you a question about the sound?
I think we moved on.
Oh, I thought they were with the speaker.
No, this is something else. This is subdivision. There will be a sound survey on them, won't there? On the power plant, there will be a sound survey. They have to pass that.
Do you want to talk about this, Bob?
Yeah. Basically, this is a major sub. We have two major subdivisions on the agenda. This one is a major because there's no public road frontage. Okay. Eugene and Patricia Fraser are the owners. They have 308 acres, and they're proposing to split off two for, is it relatives?
Yeah. Yes.
Not that it matters, but yep. I want to say that correctly. And they're accessing it through a 33-foot right-of-way that comes off of Forest Lake Road, okay? And let's see, what else? 2 acres, it meets the average width. It's a 33-foot wide easement over lands of Robert and Corinne Hawley, which who are also relatives, I believe. You're,
yeah,
you're the
parents,
right?
Parents.
Yep, son, okay.
Yeah. And Eugene's a cousin, so.
Okay, yeah. Not that it matters, but.
Yeah.
You know. They've done a perk test, soil test, and sewer planning. That's all been sent to DEP. We sent the plan to the township. The only thing outstanding is I've been trying to get a hold of the drive. Yeah, I've been trying to call Sal Donato. Doesn't seem to answer his phone. I think he's getting ready to retire, and that may be part of the reason.
Okay.
But I wanted to give him heads up that you were going to call,
okay.
You know, hopefully, and get a driveway permit. Now, the driveway, I looked at the deed. It's been there since, you know,
yeah.
1800 or something almost. You know, it's an ancient deed. The driveway's been there, I would assume, as long.
Yeah.
So I don't think there would be a problem with PennDOT, you know, giving them a driveway for that, I mean, giving them a permit for the existing driveway. So, but it's just the process.
Okay.
That
we have to go.
And that's basically all there is to it. It's a doesn't have public road frontage, and that throws it into a major, and that's about it.
How were they ever able to get a test pit dug in this kind of weather?
Yeah, it was about a month later than it was supposed to be. It was a little bit wet there for about 4.5 weeks. We had about 2 days where it was above 45 degrees and dry. We had a cousin.
We're lucky. We're not doing now.
No. It was a little bit of a delay on the perk test.
Is anybody here from Bowtie LLC?
That's the subdivision for
right.
Okay. Right.
Okay.
So, have you got the whole sound tomorrow, or have?
Tonight, okay. Now. Mm-hmm. I will.
Okay.
And I just had one quick question.
Sure.
If I wasn't going to put a house on this, could I buy the land before all this process, or?
According to that.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Is there any way to get that? Site work to it, or
no.
Is it? What if I was buying it without putting a house on it? Still the same process.
Yeah, because it's a subdivision. The township.
Okay, cool.
See, we don't require the DEP approval. The township does.
Got it. And then I'll just get a hold of Sal to drop
yeah,
a permit, and then
yeah.
get that to you guys.
Yes.
Perfect.
Yeah. What you do with a driveway permit, once they issue it, they make you record it, or they record it, and if you even let me know that it's been recorded, I can get it off of online.
Which it's an existing driveway now.
Right. It should not be an issue. What I was trying to get a hold of Sal for was he's been pretty good about finding existing driveway permits in Dunmore.
Oh.
He can investigate it, and he's come up with existing driveway permits. When I looked at the deed, though, and I saw it was such an ancient deed, I thought maybe, you know, maybe this is before that time, but I would still ask them about that.
So the waiting for the permit that they already have on record?
Yeah, that's all.
You sent the highway department?
Basically, but it's more penned, it's more Dunmore than up here.
You could call her to get his number or whatever, so. And I wouldn't tarry about that either, because even though it's an old deed, it's possible that he could find an issue with it, so don't.
We gotta hold it, get that information back to Bob.
Yeah, as soon as you can. The DEP stuff will take care of itself, you know, you're, like you said, you've already sent it in to DEP, so all you can do there is wait.
I mean, I don't think I gave you the right one money last time.
Yeah, I know, that's.
Okay, no?
Did you wanna swap this one, or?
Okay, do you want me to letter?
Well, either way, doesn't matter, we don't care. Okay, whatever you wanna do. It would be 180, or you wanna do 100, whatever you wanna do. Keep your accounting straight.
Not my department. That's why I told you to one.
And a pen doesn't work.
That's why he's here with me. I'm a chauffeur today, that's why. So that they trust me.
Okay, there you go, thank you.
Thank you. I'm gonna let you hold it at Sally.
Great, yeah, thanks.
No problem.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
I'm gonna call the July meeting of the Susquehanna County Planning Commission to order. Please rise and pledge to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First thing on the agenda is the approval of minutes, which have been circulated previously.
I'm not motion to approve the minutes.
Second. Ted, second.
Motion was made by Nancy and seconded by Ted to approve the minutes of our previous meeting. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carry. Next is communications.
And as you see, there's no DEP approvals before people.
Yeah, I guess it's. Any questions on the communications? Okay, we'll move on to county planning director's report.
There's an update, I got the NPDES permit for Dollar General just yesterday, so.
Okay.
Approved to build.
And you met with Carson and the commissioners?
Yeah, that was a good meeting. Commissioners took an active interest in what we were doing and asked questions and made suggestions, it was very helpful.
Did they actually change much of anything?
No, but we're trying to concentrate on just what the county can be responsible for. The existing comprehensive plan has all this stuff, you know, world peace and everything. We're not responsible for that. We're trying to make it so that comprehensive plan is something that the county can actually do.
Do something about.
Yeah.
And we have the deputy director's report, any questions on that? So motions in order for the two reports?
Second.
Motion was made by Rick and seconded by Ted to approve the staff reports, the county planning director and deputy. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carry. Next is public comment, which can be on items on the agenda or items which may appear on the agenda in the future. If you had your hand up first, the corner?
Yes, thank you. So I just have a point of order, a question really, first before I make my comment.
On this old business item, Express Natural Gas, is there any final approval? Are you just receiving a report today? Is that it, or?
No, it was, the Planning Commission gives, as you know, conditional approvals. They did conditional final approval for this one. So in the past, we never put on the agenda, like, whatever happened to them. They would give conditional approval, the conditions would be met, and there was no recording of it to the Planning Commission. So we started putting these just as a report only, saying, okay, we've got what the Planning Commission had asked for, and it was granted final approval. So I'm just reporting it. That's all we're doing.
Got it. So you don't have any final actions left on the...
Right, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay, I still would like to make a comment on that, if I could. Okay, so... XNG is an especially, I know you don't have any action left, but I just want to give this to you for your own information. XNG is an especially rogue operator, rogue of the law. They have violated so many laws here, and I'm just wondering if there's something that you all can do to rescind your approval, and I'll give you reasons why. First of all, you've never given them final approval. You gave them a conditional approval, and they've operated for 6 months without having a final approval. So that's one thing. The next thing is they don't have any DEP permits. Your approval was conditioned on them having their final DEP permits for their compressors. They don't have any approval from the from DEP for their compressors. They told the DEP we're exempt because the emissions are below a certain threshold, but now they're telling Caterpillar, the manufacturer, something completely different. They're saying the emissions are above the threshold. So which is it? So they're talking out both sides of their mouth. These vehicles are unsafe. These vehicles they've had two rollovers in the first 6 months of operations. And if there's a good reason why they're having the rollovers, because these trucks are overweight. There's a new kind of a trailer. They've got two different, really three different styles that they use, but the bigger one is overweight. And I have evidence that I can present to you later. How I know that, it's right off of basically the manufacturer's website, and you just add up the weight of the tractor. The tractor is underpowered and has insufficient braking. This combination of this vehicle is absolutely unsafe, and it should not be on the roads. There were at least four reportable incidents to the, there's a group, you heard of the National Response Center, the NRC, I'm sure. Whenever you have oil spills and leaks, there has to be a report to the NRC. There was one out of four reportable incidents that I know of. There's probably more. They made one call to the NRC, and actually I believe that call was made by the New York State Police. It was not made by XNG. There was a truck that started venting in Binghamton. No newspaper articles on this. You won't find it in the newspaper. But I looked it up on the NRC website. What they built is different from what they gave you on the plan. And that because what they built actually involves that second adjacent property, because they were planning on coming out that side road. I forget the name of that side road there.
Lake Hill Road.
Thank you. So, you know, there's so many violations here. There's so many irregularities. It's just absolutely uncommon. Here's another thing. They lied to you and to everybody about the true nature of this facility. They told everybody that the nature of this facility was to take gas to local customers, you know, universities, hospitals, that kind of thing. That's not what they're doing. They're doing this thing that they call pipe to pipe. They're taking the gas out of a pipe in Montrose, and they're driving 130 miles to Mannheim, New York, and sticking it into a different pipe. This is FERC jurisdiction. Speaking of permits that they don't have a certificate of public convenience and necessity for interstate commerce and natural gas from FERC. They don't have any of the required permits that they really need. And they lied to the Public Service, this is outside of your scope, of course, but they lied to the New York State Public Service Commission. They said they were exempt because of the purpose, which they lied about. And they also lied to the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And by the way, in January, when they started operations here, they made a major change to the Mannheim facility. The Mannheim facility started out, as what they said, delivering gas to local customers. In January, they flipped the direction. They installed a big, monstrous gas-fired compressor station there, and they didn't even apply to the DEC, New York State DEC, for a permit.
And they're right now under fine. They're right now under a violation order. I can show it to you right here. I have it. $15,000 per day issued on June 30th. $15,000 a day. They're still operating. They don't care. They are so rogue of the law. So I am asking you, if there's some action that you can take to shut down this dangerous operation. I haven't even gotten into and I won't get into. I'll wrap it up. But these trucks are extremely unsafe. I've spent the last 3 months researching these trucks or the trailers. I could tell you lots of stories about that, but these trailers are really unsafe. When one of these things fails catastrophically, and we've already had two accidents right out here within a mile of each other, there's going to be a very bad loss of life when that happens, and I want to see that not happen. So please shut down this rogue operator that is not following any laws. Thank you.
Anybody else?
In the minutes that you just approved, there's an item that says that Kathy Shelley responded to Ms. C. Winshoe's comment regarding conditional final approval. She reported on the actions taken by the commission at the June 13th public meeting. What did the commission, just a question, what did they say about conditional final approvals at that meeting?
The question was from the audience. Look, if it's a final approval, how can it be conditional? Because and my suggestion was that maybe we could change that terminology. In order to do that, I believe we have to change some of our procedures, and that's, so that wasn't something that we could just have a suggestion and do it right away. So I don't know whether how far it's in the works or what, because I'm Kathy Shelley, and so I really don't know how far that's proceeded.
And this is a procedure by the commission, by you.
I believe that it is confusing, and it's something that we should somehow resolve, but I don't know how. And it's not up to me to do the resolution.
But it says here that the commission, the county commission, took actions. I'm just wondering, what are the actions that they took? That's my question.
No, that was planning commission. It was planning commission. She reported on the actions taken by the commission at the June 30th or 13th. Conditional final approval was something that the planning commission had done a couple of times before for other industries. We got burnt this time. Mm-hmm. And so Chuck Winshoe asked, no more, could the planning commission consider not doing conditional final approvals? And I think the commission would agree to that.
So there were no more conditional final approvals?
No. That's,
but you didn't withdraw the conditional final approval for XNG?
No, because the action had been taken.
But before they met the conditions, they haven't met the conditions.
Yes, but there was. Yeah,
so why can't you undo it?
There was no, special meeting, I believe, somebody in the audience asked whether or not the planning commission would rescind the previous action, and that didn't happen. So, consequently, the conditional final still held.
Here's a problem. The gentleman is right. The New York State equivalent of the DEP has fined XNG $33,000 a day starting in January. It's several million dollars at this point. And what they're being fined for is transporting the gas that they take from here to New York State. That's what they're saying is illegal. And they say it's illegal because they're operating a natural gas compressor without obtaining a permit. They're operating a facility which is an air contamination source without a permit. And they're operating a compressor without a permit. And they say it says also to the officers of XNG that they're going to put them in jail if they keep doing it. We are enabling all of this illegal action by allowing them to do this particular activity here. All they're doing is doing what we're enabling them to do, bringing it up to New York State. If all of this is horror, and they don't have any of these permits here, they made the same statements to us here as they've made to the people in New York State. We don't need to do it. The New York State says, nonsense, of course you need to do it, and until you do it, you got to pay us $33,000 a day. Well, if that's true in New York, why isn't it true here? Why should we enable them?
Anybody else?
Well, it's still in front of DEP, isn't it?
Yeah.
DEP hasn't, we don't know that.
There is no DEP permit.
No, it's in consideration with the engineering department of DEP for the permit that they need. It takes several months to get that.
Do we have any other comments?
Yes. I'd like to say also that you approved, gave a final approval, what's the date on, for XNG? Was it July 7th or 10th? When did they get final approval from the commission? July 10th. And I want to know, is it legal to give final approval without having a public presentation of that, like you do now? You have us here in the public to hear the final or the conditional approvals. How can you give one just without having your public meeting? Is that considered legal, or are you truly within the law?
That's what I just said to Jake. The commission gave, granted, at a public meeting, conditional final approval, conditioned on receipt of the sound study. Once we received the sound study, then it was approved on July, or it was 10th. It didn't have to come back to a meeting. That's not gonna happen again in the future. Not that it helps this situation.
You mean there won't be any more conditional approvals?
Conditional final approval.
No conditional final approvals?
Yeah, right.
And then I also want to say...
But don't these people need a DEP permit?
Yes, they do, but it's not in the conditional approval. They forgot, they didn't put it in there.
Yeah.
So it's not required.
But...
They do need it. That was later.
Request that as, they made an action. Conditional final approval conditioned on the sound study, period. Not DEP, not anything else. So that's...
And the trees. And the trees.
And the trees.
And the trees.
And the trees were planted, yeah. That's what happened.
And I have another comment. I didn't finish because I just wanted to say, too. I visited XNG before I came to the meeting tonight at about 5:00, 5:30. Their wall, parts of their wall that they had up originally for the sound survey and to be approved, sections are missing as of today. So part of the wall is down, and also both generators are operating. You can see the emissions coming out of the stacks. So they're still operating with part of the wall, two sections, one in the front, one in the back corner, are missing. So as far as I'm concerned, it's not the same wall that they had for the approval of the noise survey. So as far as I can see, they're in violation even right now of the noise survey because some of the wall is missing. Can that be a consideration?
No.
And why not?
The ordinance, as our solicitor and previous solicitor said, the ordinance applies to the sound study that has to be met prior to final approval. Once final approval is granted, they could take all of their insulation out, they could take the sound walls out, they could make as much noise as they want.
And when was final approval made?
July 10th.
So now if they're exceeding the sound, you can't go back and say, you can't shut them down?
Nope.
Then can you, as a commission, please add something to the sound survey that once they are approved, even later, if they're found in violation, that they can be shut down? You cannot subject us, the residents, to noise above the 50 decibels just because of a inappropriate noise ordinance. Can you please consider that and add to the noise ordinance?
The commissioners said that they would consider changing the noise ordinance.
So that, okay, so they'll change it so that they can be also...
I'm not saying no changes. They said they would consider it.
They would consider it. And also I'm asking for the commissioners and the commission to have their own noise meters for our county to protect us from this noise that's ongoing 24/7 out of all the compressor stations, which are 50 of them, besides now the power plants coming in and the compressed stations. And to also do your own noise ordinance survey if somebody comes in to see if these surveys are correct, because right now the survey just pulled through. With the wall, they came in at 48 decibels. That means they just made it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the commissioners are looking into that. I mean, they asked, I've done some research on buying a piece of sound equipment.
Good.
Yep. Nothing's happened yet, but it is in the time.
So right now they can remove the whole wall.
Right, and that's...
That's why some of it is missing, and they're not in violation.
Right.
That's, you know, that's, you know, outrageous. We need to change something seriously.
Yes, what was pointed out, right or wrong, that the way the ordinance is written, it is a design standard, not a maintenance standard.
So we have to add...
There's no maintenance in there.
And then who decides on that? Is it the commissioner? So they have to add a maintenance standard?
Yeah, if they want to, you know, that's up to them.
Well, it's up to them, but it's also up to the people of this county who can talk to the commissioners and suggest and give our input that we need this to protect this county. So...
That's where we're at now.
That's where you're at right now?
Right. That's the issue with this.
And so far, they've only been fined $10,000 in our county? And who made the fine? Is that from the commissioners?
Yeah, probably. I don't know that.
It is.
Is it? Was it?
So it's not from the commission, right?
No, that wasn't the planning commission, I know that much.
The woman behind there.
The planning commission does not...
Want to give your name, please?
Huh? Excuse me, wait.
The planning commission can't do that.
Can't do fines, you mean?
The planning commission can't do, can't...
We have no enforcement.
We have no enforcement. It all goes back to the county commissioners.
So the commissioners are the enforcers?
They are the enforcers.
Okay, so then we have to talk to them and encourage them to enforce. Thank you.
Let me give your name for Bob, please.
Sure. This is my first time actually attempting to speak within a public forum, so please bear with me. My name is Allison Mayes, M-A-Y-E-S. I'm a former truck driver of the hazmat vehicles that XNG is operating. I was the driver that was involved in the most, well, not most recent, I was the driver involved in the February 21st, rollover, through no fault of my own. I have gone to court. I have called Lieutenant Kroll of the Commercial Safety of Pennsylvania. I've gone above the Pennsylvania State Police Department. I have begged, I have pleaded, I have, you name it, I have tried to speak to anybody that will listen to try to get them to look into these trucks. I was a former driver, just a little background of myself. I'm the former XNG driver. I'm prior military police. I served for 4.5 years active duty for the United States Army. I'm a former water truck driver, so I'm very, very familiar with the fluid movements within a vehicle. I can attest to the fact that if you looked into the demographics of everything within the accident prior to coming up to the turn, I am not 100%. I believe it's Forest Lake Road is right before I rolled the vehicle onto its side, onto the driver's side. Given my background, everything that I've gone through, that is probably the most traumatic event that I've ever gone through within my life. There was nothing that I could do. I have tormented myself for the last 5 months questioning. I attempted to go to Kozlowski's Towing to look into the tractor, to receive answers as to why. Why did that truck go onto its side? I investigated that. I mean, I am the most thorough person you could think of when it comes to, you know, by the book, black and white. Some research has been conducted. There is a steering linkage recall on the tractors. To my knowledge, they have not fixed that. I attempted to go to Kozlowski's Towing to look at the truck so I could take photos, so I could look into the accident, so I could find out as to why the fifth wheel pin broke loose and sheared off, and I laid a tractor onto its side, so I could look into the steering linkage. I was denied time and time again. I requested to look at photos. They would not provide me any photos other than nothing to explain why that tractor trailer went onto its side. I was hauling a Quantum, to be exact. There are two different vehicles that are trailers that are prior to me being fired, which I was fired, ironically, March 8th for doing 60 miles an hour in a 30 mile an hour zone with no GPS fix. So without any authority, any evidence, any validation, they just went ahead and fired me. With the most recent accident that occurred, there was a problem that was reported by one of the current drivers of the steering column broke. I spoke personally with the driver, and if you can find any way, I beg, I plead, And my accident is done. My name is already tainted. My name has been in the papers time and time again. I've spoke with the county commissioner. They need to be shut down. Not because of fracking, not because of the air quality control, X, Y, and Z. I mean, that is a concern. I'm not just sweeping that underneath the rug. I am concerned for the public safety. Thank God nobody else was traveling on that, on the other side of the lane. I was cited for failure to obey the lane. I went to court. I fought the ticket. So essentially, I was cited $138 because the tractor trailer broke, the fifth wheel slide broke, the steering broke, and I laid a tractor trailer down onto the driver's side. I had damages to my hand. I can no longer drive, nor do I really want to drive, to be honest. I have severe damage to my hand. The company doesn't care. They just fired me. I took a tow hook to the head because the mechanic didn't have enough time to be able to tuck the tow hooks away onto the frame. You're aware of what is publicly known? What happens behind closed doors? And I've seen it. But you continue to work because everybody needs to make money. Everybody needs to provide for a living. If there's anything that this commission can do, I plead, please look into it. I don't know who else to speak to. I spoke with the state police of Gibson. I spoke with Lieutenant Kroll of Harrisburg, safety of commercial vehicles. I don't know where else to go if anybody has any recommendations. And it's not a matter of shutting a company down. It's a matter of just doing the right thing, following the correct procedures. And it scares me to think what will happen next.
Do you have an attorney?
I have attempted to find attorneys, but what it comes down to is the fact that I didn't kill anybody, thank God, and there wasn't enough personal injury to me. So it's not a big bread, money, winning case. Nobody wants to pick it up.
Who permits the trucks? Is it the state? Is it federal?
I believe that goes by DOT. So if the trucks fall in within the limits of 80,000 pounds, they are authorized to haul 80,000 pounds. That's your standard Class A commercial vehicle. The tractor itself is weighted for 53,300. So there's a bridge formula that is taken into effect onto that. I don't know what other doors to knock on, but I mean, if anything that this commission could do, it needs to be done, at least hauling the Quantums. The Quantums are the most unsafe trailer ever. What they essentially did to haul more gas is took the integrity of this vehicle, raised it up even higher, added Titan is four cylinders. They added, I believe it's 45 cylinders that the Quantums have, raised it up, messed with the center of gravity, and it's, as a driver, it was the most unsafe feeling, extremely unsafe feeling.
That's why I ask you, like, who permits these? Do they look into the construction, the center of gravity, and
It makes you wonder. Honestly, it makes you wonder because the Titans are a shorter trailer. Let me just validate that. Yes, they are horizontal, four horizontal cylinders. So what they did is they jacked up these trailers, and then they jacked up these trailers, added the cylinders are now vertical, and all the hardware is on the top. So the center of gravity is.
Well, if we think of something, we'll do what we can. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
PennDOT, she said. You talked to PennDOT, right? You spoke to people at PennDOT.
PennDOT? No. I spoke with the state police, that's Gibson State Police. The trooper, Mitchell, had actually urged me to drop the ticket and just pay the fine. He explained that he could have cited me for an unsecure load, which technically it was an unsecure load because gas leaked into the air because of the accident. He had attempted to get me to drop the ticket, and I wouldn't drop the ticket.
Okay. This doesn't, like, we rescind our license, the licensing and registration.
Department of Transportation.
Department of Transportation.
Your motor vehicles.
Did your truck tip over or just the trailer?
The whole unit as one. So it was not the king.
The fifth wheel broke, right?
Fifth wheel slide.
I'm trying to.
Yes, fifth wheel slide. So the fifth wheel slide, it adjusted, sheared off.
Went on your tires and tipped.
All I know, I can't tell you all the demographics. All I know is the unit as one landed on its side, and I skid across the pavement with my hand out the window.
What about our Senator, Lisa Baker?
I will write that down.
It's a possibility.
I mean, I know as, like, for instance, New Hampshire requires that the Titans have an extra emergency release valve. So therefore, if it gets too high of a pressure, or if it gets too high of a temperature, it will automatically release the gas. It's a safety measure. That is New Hampshire law itself.
I would talk to Senator Lisa Baker, and our representative is Jonathan Fritz. I'm sure you can get their numbers online, or Bob has them.
Can you please repeat them again?
Lisa Baker, she's a senator. And then the state representative is Jonathan Fritz.
Thank you.
He has an office right out here by Montrose Lake. Do you know where Lake Montrose is?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. He has an office out there. There's a big sign and his name is on it.
Thank you. On the left before Price Chopper.
Definitely.
And someone is there Monday through Friday, as far as I've called that office.
I've spoke with the...
And somebody is there Monday through Friday.
I really didn't start to advocate any of this. I've mostly beat myself up for the last 5 months trying to understand what happened exactly. And it wasn't until the most recent accident, and when I found out about that, that I called Alan Hall and explained, like, please look into the accident, investigate it as far as you can. And if you had read the newspapers, you were able to see that there was a conflict of interest between the Forest Lake captain, I believe.
Fire chief,
yeah. Okay, military. The fire chief between the emergency response as well, so they weren't able to look into it anymore.
Well, there are representatives to Harrisburg, so I would contact them and see what they, at least give your story.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. They can help you. Roll and at least know who to investigate this kind of situation. Definitely.
It's from my understanding, yeah. There's also another compressor station that is also in the process.
Yeah.
If I could, as a driver, previous driver, if I could make a recommendation, I think the worst part was these county roads. Driving on these county roads, these tractor trailers are really not, they're not built to be on these roads. One, a compressed natural gas tractor in comparison to a diesel, and two, the tractor trailers don't belong essentially on North Road. So if you can take that into consideration into your future planning and approvals.
Just a little background on that. If Forest Lake and other townships, we work with them. When I say we, Planning Commission and a consultant worked with them for many years, putting together a zoning ordinance. If Forest Lake and other townships would have passed that zoning ordinance when they should have, this would never be there, would never be allowed to be there on North Road with those conditions. But the township decided not to.
Interesting, thank you.
And what zoning laws would have been enacted that could have been enacted that could have prevented it? Like what?
The Northern Tier Coalition was a group of 12 municipalities.
Mm-hmm.
All of the commercial, industrial, the benefit of working as a group like that, let me back up a little bit. In zoning, you have to allow for every use and every conceivable use. So somebody comes along, this was not a use that anybody knew about, but this came along, had to be allowed somewhere. The benefit of doing this multi-municipal zone, whereas that they could share uses, not every township had to have every use. The commercial and industrial, in this zoning ordinance that they set up and they didn't pass, all of the commercial and industrial use was going to be in Bridgewater Township. Forest Lake, Choconut, Middletown, Silver Lake would not have any commercial or industrial use. This wouldn't have been allowed if they would have passed that zoning ordinance.
So then you could have like a zone, an industrial zone, which would have been Bridgewater Township, and then all the other townships would be exempt?
That would take care of the requirement for making a place for industrial and commercial.
And it was just Bridgewater in the whole county?
They had it all set, and Bridgewater, well, I think Montrose might have been one, you know, because, but the idea was that's where the sewer and the water and the roads are. You know, and that's, that part of Forest Lake never would have been a commercial, you know, been allowed to be a commercial area, industrial area.
Okay, do we have any other public comment?
Well, I did want to ask a question about the sound, about the facility they were talking about. They were talking about compressors in, separate compressors in metal buildings. And I was just...
The engines, right?
Oh, the engines.
Yeah, sure.
And I was just wondering how you can soundproof each one separately so that the 50 decibels for all of them can be met. I mean, can the planning commission ask how they're going to do that?
I know that's up to them to...
We just ask them to do it, or it doesn't matter to us how they do it, as long as they do it.
As long as it meets the requirement.
Okay, then that gives me another question, because you're talking about the study, the sound study. It just seems to me that the sound study is saying that their facility will be within 50 decibels. But then there's nothing, I mean, then they plant the trees or put in the barriers or whatever it is, and then they take them away. So how can we know that this, just a study is sufficient? Because if they don't follow what the study ends up with 50 decibels, then how are
Because that's what the ordinance requires, as Bob said before.
Yeah.
That it requires, the sound study requires 50 decibel when you give the final approval. It's a design standard, is what you call it, right?
A design standard, not a maintenance standard.
So the design standard is supposed to mean that they
Design
their facilities to constantly meet the 50 decibels.
Yeah.
But then...
But we have no mechanism to enforce that after final approval.
That's how the ordinance is.
Well, I don't know if you feel you can ask them how, or does the sound study actually spell it out for you how they're going to enclose these engines?
No, it just, it either meets it or it doesn't.
I don't understand why you don't want to know how they're going to do it.
What difference does it make?
Because it may not be true.
Well, it has to be true.
Well, if it doesn't, then it won't pass.
Correct. Some engineer is putting their livelihood on the line by, if they lie to us and tell us and give us a study that's not accurate.
Well, I mean, an engine in a metal building is going to emit all its noise. It's going to go right through the metal. So.
Well, you don't know that.
I do know that. Because
well, that's
I've
a supposition. But a sound engineer says that it's less than 50 decibels, and we get a document. A legal document that says that. So you're asking us to question the validity of that document?
Yes.
How would we do that?
Yes,
well, no,
definitely.
We're not going to do that.
Yes.
We're not going to do that.
We'll ask the commissioners to do it.
You're welcome to do that, but that's not our role.
Right, it's not your role.
It seems like what they tell you they're going to do in the end doesn't always happen all the time.
The only thing we can do is take our concerns and yours to the commissioners and say, look, it looks like they're built these temporary walls so that they were able to do the sound study showing compliance, and so it's approved. It was approved on July 10th, and since it's been approved, it doesn't matter. They can take the walls away and have as many decibels as they want, which is something that we had not encountered before. We've always worked with people that were working in good faith. And this is a group which is obviously not. So in order to counteract that and to, we have to ask that the county commissioners, maybe we can even write them a something that they could pass, saying that it had to be maintained at 50 decibels, and that if it was ever not maintained at 50 decibels, that they would be in, not, they would no longer be in compliance.
And then what would you do?
Yeah, that's... Yeah.
And the county commissioners could also say that it would be $15,000 a day for every day that they're not in compliance, which the state of New York seems to have done with the same group.
For a different reason, but nonetheless.
For different reasons.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right now we don't have that, you know, like you said, the fine, we don't have
We don't have the fine, we don't have any of it.
Well, can you accomplish this before anything else is permitted?
Can you send a letter to the commissioners with these concerns?
I think that Bob's been talking about.
Yeah, they are concerned.
And they are concerned.
Yes, they are.
Okay. So you don't have to have a letter just from all of you? A letter stating the concerns to make a new noise ordinance?
They're looking at it.
Yeah, they are. I know Alan is. Yeah.
Okay, so you
can do their job.
Okay. When we had that special meeting, we asked that that special meeting, the recordings from that special meeting, be made available to the county commissioners so that they could also hear your comments and your concerns during the public comment and during that special meeting, which was just on this particular issue. And I believe that was done, wasn't it?
When was the special meeting? Which one are you talking about?
13th.
June 13th.
Oh, you mean the county commissioners meeting?
Yeah.
No.
The planning commission had a special meeting.
Oh, okay.
It was right here, I think, wasn't it?
Downstairs.
Which we recorded. And the record was sent to the, I asked that the record be sent to the county commissioners. And yes, they said they were going to do that. Who were attending the meeting.
So we didn't record that. Somebody at the meeting recorded
it. Someone at the meeting was recording it, and that person said yes, he would make that available to them.
And there was some public at that meeting?
It was Bill.
There were public?
Yes.
It was Bill.
We actually took what the public had brought to the meeting and asked if they would make that available to the county commissioners so that they would know of everybody's concerns, not just ours.
Okay.
Nancy, can we move on?
Okay, yes.
Thank you.
Let's move on to old business. Subdivision land development review. There's none at this time. B, report of finalized conditional approvals. Express natural gas, Forest Lake CNG Center, commercial development. Forest Lake Township received a sound study showing compliance with the ordinance, and it was approved July 10th, 2017. New business, subdivision land development review. Number one is Eugene and Patricia Fraser, one lot major subdivision in Forest Lake Township, requesting conditional, preliminary, and final approval. I think you have those maps, the Fraser. You should have the Fraser map.
Yeah. Okay.
And Bob has this.
Okay. Eugene and Patricia Fraser, 1075 Fraser Road, Montrose, have proposed a one-lot major subdivision of their lands located along State Route 3029 Forest Lake Road in Forest Lake Township. Mr. and Mrs. Fraser intend to divide a two-acre lot as a house site for Dr. and Mrs. Andrew Hawley. In reviewing the plan, the following items are called to your attention. Number one, by definition, this is a major subdivision since the lot does not have public road frontage. Number two, application affidavit of ownership and filing fee have been received. Number three, survey maps were prepared by Scott Williams, PLS of Butler Land Surveying of Little Meadows, PA. Number four, lot four contains 2.00 acres and has an average width of 210 feet with 150 feet required. Remaining lands contain 308 acres and are developed with the owner's house. Number five, access will be provided by a 33-foot wide easement across lands of Robert and Corinne Hawley. The easement contains the existing driveway of Robert and Corinne Hawley, which will be extended to the proposed new lot. A driveway permit for the existing driveway is required prior to granting preliminary and final approval. Number six, vert test and sewer planning module have been completed and sent to DEP for approval. DEP approval will be required prior to granting preliminary and final approval. And number seven, the Forest Lake Township supervisors were notified on July 18th, and their next regular meeting is scheduled for August 7th. So the staff recommendation is grant preliminary and final approval of the Fraser Major Subdivision, conditioned on receipt of a DEP approval of the sewage planning module, a copy of a driveway permit as issued by PennDOT, and in receipt of the municipality report form from the Forest Lake Township supervisors within the commission's allowable review period.
I make the motion to concur with staff recommendations.
A second.
Motion has been made by John Ramsey and seconded by Kathy Shelley to grant preliminary and final approval of the Bowtie LLC major subdivision, conditioned on receipt. Okay, a motion was made by John Ramsey and seconded by Kathy Shelley to grant preliminary and final approval of the Fraser Major Subdivision, conditioned on receipt of DEP approval of the sewage planning module, a copy of a driveway permit as issued by PennDOT, and receipt of municipality report form from the Forest Lake Township supervisors within the commission's allowable review period. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Okay, next is Bowtie LLC Coleman, one lot major subdivision, Oakland Township, requesting conditional, preliminary, and final approval. And Eleanor has this one.
Did you hand out a map with that one, Bob?
Oh. No, I don't think so.
No, it should be in your file here.
There isn't anything in here. This is just paperwork.
Okay, where is it? It's in the office somewhere.
There isn't any.
It's the first sheet in the...
Yeah, that's what it is. No wonder. Okay.
The first two sheets is the subdivision.
Yeah, it's in the big packet here.
Okay.
I'm thinking, where the heck is it?
Sorry, I wasn't paying much attention.
Bowtie LLC, Robert and Donna Coleman,
yes,
owners.
It is Great Bend. This is... Okay, let me explain that. Rick just asked that. It says Oakland and Great Bend. Mm-hmm. The land development is in Oakland Township. The subdivision is in Great Bend because it's right now it's assessed in Great Bend, right?
That is correct.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's kind of confusing. Once it gets subdivided, it's going to be Oakland's lot.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the second page, second and third pages.
This.
Right. Yep.
Okay.
Bowtie LLC, Robert and Donna Coleman, owners. 5212 Brushville Road have proposed a one-lot major subdivision of their lands located along a private road off from State Route 1023 Oak Hill Road in Great Bend Township. Bowtie LLC intends to convey a parcel of land to Mineral Point LLC for the development of an electric generation plant. In reviewing the plan, the following items are called to your attention. One, by definition, this is a major subdivision since the lot does not have public road frontage. Two, application, affidavit of ownership, and filing fee have been received. Three, survey maps were prepared by Timothy Milholland, PLS of McTish, Kunkel, and Associates of Montoursville, PA. Four, lot one contains 3 acres and has an average width of 440 feet, 170 feet required. A 50-foot easement of a 10-acre connects lot 3 to the private road and crosses the existing Angelina Gathering Pipeline. Remaining lands contain 52 acres and are not developed. 5. Access to the site is by way of a private road that connects to State Route 1023 Oak Hill Road. A driveway permit for the private road was issued in 2015 for the Bluestone Gallery development of a natural gas compressor station on lands of Kisslinger. 6. A waiver of sewage planning has been submitted to the Council of Governments for the eventual development of this lot, which will occur in Oakland Township. A copy of the approved waiver will be required prior to granting preliminary and final approval. 7. The Great Bend Township supervisors were notified on July 12th. Their next regular meeting is scheduled for August 7th.
staff recommendation grant preliminary and final approval of the Bow Tie LLC major subdivision conditioned on receipt of a copy of the approved sewage planning waiver from the Council of Governments and receipt of the municipality report form from the Great Bend Township supervisors within the commission's allowable review period.
If you have any questions or comments on this one?
Make a motion to concur with staff recommendation.
I want to object to this private road. Sounds like there's just a private road going to this facility. Is that what I understand? Am I understanding it correctly?
Can we go on with our business, please?
Private road, in case there's emergency management people, if there's an explosion or a problem at this power plant, you have a private road leading to it. Are our emergency people going to be denied access if we need to go on that road?
We have a motion. I'm waiting for the second, and then we will
discuss it. I second the motion.
Then we can discuss it?
We can discuss it. You can ask for permission to discuss it.
A motion was made by Rick and seconded by Chris to grant preliminary and final approval of the Bow Tie LLC major subdivision conditioned on receipt of a copy of the approved sewage planning waiver from the Council of Governments and receipt of the municipality report form from the Great Bend Township supervisors within the commission's allowable review period. Any discussion, comments?
Yeah, and this private driveway road slash road, it has a 50-foot right of way.
Yes.
50-foot access easement containing 4.67, practically 5 acres. And it looks like it has an extra length so that it doesn't have to go way up and over. It goes around an area that looks like it would be very steep. So it looks to me as if this is about the safest driveway that they could have built, and I'm sure that that's exactly what they did, given the terrain. That's just my comment.
And that meets our requirements, correct, Bob?
Yeah, this is an existing private road that serves quarries, a compressor station.
It's already been there for quite a while.
Yeah, 4-star pass road or something like that. It's got nothing that the name matters, but it's not something that they're developing right now. It's an existing private road.
Okay.
Correct.
I want to make a comment, objection from public, that if this is a private road, if there's an emergency, will it be easier for them, the compressor station company plus the power plant, to deny access if they wanted to, as far as investigators and as far as emergency people, because they could say this is private and you have to stay out? I don't see how this should be allowed to have a private road to a major industrial area for the protection of the public.
You note that, Bob? Okay, a motion was made by Rick, seconded by Chris, to grant the preliminary and final approval of the Bow Tie, conditioned on receipt of the approved sewage planning waiver from GOG and receipt of the municipality report form from the Great Bend supervisors within the commission's allowable review period. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Next is Mineral Point Energy Facility, IMG Industrial Development in Oakland Township, requesting conditional preliminary approval. And Bob has this.
Mineral Point Energy LLC, 358 North Shore Drive, Suite 201, Pittsburgh, PA, has proposed an industrial development on 3 acres of land along a private road in Oakland Township, which will be purchased from Robert and Donna Coleman. Iron Mountain Generation Midstream will develop the site with an electric generation facility. In reviewing the plan, the following items are called to your attention. Number one, by definition, this is an industrial land development. Number two, application, affidavit of ownership, and filing fee have been received. Number three, site development plans were prepared by Quentin Wood, PE of McTish Kunkel and Associates of Montoursville, PA. Survey information was provided by Timothy Milholland, PLS of McTish Kunkel and Associates. Number four, Iron Mountain Generation intends to develop a 3-acre site with an electric generation facility consisting of 6 enclosed engines, each on a 56-foot by 55-foot concrete pad, a 15-foot by 40-foot electrical room, a substation, and a 31-foot by 70-foot building to house mechanical tanks and other equipment. The surface of the pad will be gravel. Access, number five, access to the site is via a private road that connects to State Route 1023 Oak Hill Road. Driveway permit for the private road was issued in 2015 for the Bluestone Gathering development of a natural gas compressor station on lands of Kisslinger. Number six, a waiver of sewer planning had been submitted to Council of Governments. A copy of the approved waiver will be required prior to granting preliminary approval. Number seven, an application for an NPDES permit has been submitted to the Conservation District Office. A copy of the approved permit will be required prior to granting preliminary approval. Number eight, application has been made to the Conservation District Office for general permits 5, 7, and 8. Copies of the approved permits will be required prior to granting preliminary approval. Number nine, according to the engineer, an air quality permit is required by DEP and has been submitted to DEP for review, and a copy of that approved permit will be required prior to granting preliminary approval. Number 10, lighting of the site will be via pole lights around the perimeter of the pad. The lights will be motion activated and shielded to prevent air beyond the boundary of the lot. Number 11, a 6-foot-high fence with barbed wire and gate will surround the pad area. Number 12, the closest dwelling is approximately 1,230 feet southwest of the site. Natural screening will be provided by existing trees between the site and the dwelling. And number 13, the Oakland Township supervisors were notified on July 12th, and their next meeting is scheduled for August 8th. So the staff recommendation is grant preliminary approval of the Mineral Point Energy LLC industrial land development conditioned on receipt of a copy of the approved sewer waiver from the Council of Governments, a copy of the approved NPDES permit from the Conservation District Office, a copy of the approval letter or letters for the general permits 5, 7, and 8 from the Conservation District Office, a copy of the approved air quality permit from DEP, and receipt of the municipality report form from the Oakland Township supervisors within the commission's allowable review period.
Now, Bob, I just want to say there could be other DEP permits required, not just air quality. Can you include all DEP permits required? Could there be, there could be operating permits, there could be others, not just air quality. They have to, they have, what other permits can you say are you applying for the DEP? Do you know?
No, we're applying for the air permits to run the facility, but we wouldn't qualify for an operating permit until it's already built. So at this stage, we wouldn't build it unless we had the, you know, the first initial air permit. And so those are all permits to my knowledge.
And what about the operating permit?
You apply for the operating permit after the facility is operating.
Should we include that also?
No.
I don't think it needs to be
in preliminary
approval. It needs to be in a final
but
approval.
But let's nip this right now. You're not going to do conditional final. If it doesn't come until you're operating, you can't operate until we get final approval.
Chicken or egg.
Ain't going to work. Right?
Am I saying that correctly, Quinn?
Yeah, the operating permit is really more proof that you are complying with the air permit and
right.
The emissions that you said that you're going to achieve. So we need the air permit, we need the NPDES, we need the general permit, we need the non-building sewage waiver in order to actually go out there to get our building and land development approval as well, in order for us to get all the permits to start the construction of the facility. Once the facility is up and running, they then go back through and they perform tests on the emissions, and then they submit that to the department, which shows compliance with their air permit, which in turn gives them their operating permit. It's similar to getting a occupancy permit from the building inspector when you go to construct a house. They're not going to let you move in there until you have your occupancy permit by having the inspector come and make sure that it was built according to the plans in your building permit. It's just along the same line.
Well, my concern is that even if they have the, they have to wait for the air permit, are they allowed to continue to operate? They need to not operate after their initial operation.
We just gave the library permission final approval before they have their certificate of occupancy.
Right, but they don't have an air quality issue.
Doesn't make any difference what the operation is. It's whether or not they're in compliance with our regulations.
Right.
Right, but our ordinance does say environmental permits. Is this an environmental permit or an operating permit? I don't know how this would work with our ordinance. Because they have to operate, they have to get the planning commission's approval to open for business, more or less.
Motion was made by Nancy Worley and seconded by John Ramsey to concur with the staff recommendation as read by Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Next, we have Act 170 review and comment. Here's one, Joseph and Lorraine Dolce, one lot minor subdivision in Arad Township. A positive comment with recommendation for a driveway permit and sewer planning on remaining lands. We need a motion on this, right?
Just confirm.
Just to concur with the staff.
Would you like to hear what has happened since? Because we have got the driveway permit.
Okay.
And because the land is agricultural and will continue to be agricultural, there is no need for the sewer plan.
The non-building waiver?
Right.
Okay. So we need a motion to concur with staff action.
So moved.
Second.
Motion was made by Chris and seconded by Ted to concur with staff action on Act 170 review and comment. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Next, we have staff approvals, Meyer subdivision and additions through July 21st. There's number one, Donald and Lisa Allen in Lennox Township. There was one lot, 11.27 acres, remaining lands 1.75 acres. It was approved July 13th. Does anybody want to see that one? Okay, motion is in order to concur with staff approval.
So moved.
Second.
Motion was made by Rick and seconded by Kathy to concur with staff approval for minor subdivision additions, number one, Donald and Lisa Allen. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Next are minor subdivision new lots through July 21st. Jason Robertson in Brooklyn Township, one lot, 10 acres. Remaining lands, 100.52 acres, approved July 10th. Number two is Donald and Sharon Marshall. Do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I wanted to make sure you knew Jason Robertson was at the meeting last month, and the planning commission looked at it and said that he needed a driveway permit.
Okay.
And so they did get a driveway permit. That was the thing for having the S.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So you put the two together.
Yeah, that's right. It was a farm or something.
Right, right.
Okay, so number two is Donald and Sharon Marshman, New Milford Borough, one lot, 1.94 acres, remaining lands, 1.21 acres.
And that's for Dollar General.
Okay.
Subdivision for Dollar General.
Approved July 20th. And number three is Corbin Family Irrevocable Trust in Brooklyn Township, one lot, 1.50 acres, remaining lands, 150 acres. Approved July 21st.
Make a motion to concur with staff actions, minor subdivisions, new lots through July 21st, 2017, titles 1, 2, and 3.
Second.
Motion was made by Rick and seconded by Ted to concur with staff approvals, minor subdivision new lots, numbers 1 through 3. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. We have no major subdivision new lots and no land development.
Again, this might be confusing. Jason Robertson came to the planning commission, was on the agenda, but it didn't pass. It was denied. So once they got, it was a minor subdivision. They were asking for a waiver. The waiver wasn't granted. So it went back to being just a regular minor subdivision. So that's how we could approve it in-house.
Okay.
I'm not trying to sneak anything.
Because it had road frontage and they got a driveway.
Yeah, then they met all the basic requirements for a minor subdivision, so I was able to do it rather than asking for any kind of waivers or anything.
So they got the driveway permit.
Right, they did get the driveway permit.
But they complained that they weren't.
Yeah, they had no time to do it, but they got it right away.
Amazing.
I think that's kind of. Are there other items of discussion for the planning commission?
What about this question about putting two RVs on a site that contains a house and mobile?
He didn't come tonight.
He didn't come, but he's, that man has called a few times that he wants to, we've had this before where, you know, gas industry people come, especially pipeline people, they come in their RVs, they don't have a place to put it because we don't really have RV parks.
Right.
So they plop it in somebody's backyard. Well, that's what he wanted to do. Put a couple, you know, 2, 3, 5, 10, whatever in his backyard. I told him on the phone that there's requirements in the ordinance for an RV park. He looked at it and he said, well, that's not what I'm doing. I'm just, you know, not, it's not a recreational place. It's just a place for people to stay. So I said, we've talked about this at the planning commission meeting before, and the planning commission was not willing to, you know, do anything different. So he would said, well, I'll come and talk to the planning commission. He hasn't. So that's where that stands.
Now, when you say there's no RV parks in our county, that's, is that true?
Well, RV, yeah, there's not that I know of.
I thought we had these campgrounds where they have all these RV sections and they can put RVs and park them.
Do they?
Yeah, that's what I thought. And I see a bunch. There's at least two. There's one in the Brooklyn area and one in the Bridgewater Township.
They must be really old, huh?
Oh, they are pretty old, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
See, what the ordinance says now, you have to have recreation areas and walkways and lighting and all, you know, like, as if you were setting it up for people to come and park an RV and go in a lake.
Well, that's what they
like
have
that.
Now, yeah. With those two. They have lakes.
Well, yeah,
and
Mr. Benedict, remember?
A pond.
That's right.
Over on the East Lake Road. Is that what you're talking about or no? Mm-hmm.
Well, we have East Lake Road.
No,
yeah,
that's
we have.
That's actual park.
That's
right.
A camp.
That is a camp. That is.
It's a campground.
Yeah,
with, yeah, and they have RVs there.
Yeah, and that was set up as, you know, under the ordinance. That's right.
There's one on the edge of Bridgewater Township.
Camp Road
or whatever.
Yeah.
Was that Ben, Mr. Bendix?
That's up over the hill from Williams Pond.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Have a swimming pool and a store and all that stuff.
Yeah. Right.
But, you know, nowadays you go around and you see trailers in, you know, RVs in people's backyards.
Right.
You know, 706 going over in the Milford
relatives.
Yeah, I see those. And how are they legal, Bob?
Yeah, they're not.
So can they be reported then if they're not legal?
We talked about this before, again, with the county solicitor. And what happens is by the time you go through all the legal process, they're gone.
Right. Doesn't the ordinance say something about two?
Two or more.
Two or more. So one is.
Yeah,
is
one is okay.
Legit.
Grandma can stay there, but two or more. Right.
Two or more problem?
It's an RV park. Right. You know, the only thing that, and I mentioned to the fella, we can't give him any definite answer, but he could come and ask for waivers of certain requirements in the ordinance. If he wanted to go and, you know, develop a plan. Roland Sharp did this. He was the last one that came to the meeting with, he was trying to help out a neighbor that they wanted to put a few RVs on, but they didn't want to go all through the recreation area and the, you know, the open space and all that requirements that we needed. But they ended up not doing it.
But aren't the townships really responsible in the
for
sewage part of it?
But an RV is self-contained, right?
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to have some place to get rid of the sewage.
Flying J.
And you have to have a water.
We've got an answer for all of this.
Yeah. 10 bucks, Flying J.
Flying J has a dump station.
Yeah. Yeah. It's weird. It's
worth a local field. But if you look, I mean, most of those places have, there's pipes coming up out of the ground.
Is there?
Yeah. There are.
My sister is parked in my other sister's backyard tonight with an RV to a drive, and she
go
goes in.
Tell her to get out.
She goes in. She showers at my sister. She uses the bathroom. She's just plugged into electricity. She's not using anything in the RV.
And she's only one. But if you had two sisters, that with two RVs, that would be an issue.
Then in my yard, I have a camper.
One in her yard and one in the other yard.
I have a camper in my yard tonight too. So.
Anyway.
Uh-oh. That's six grandchildren sleeping there.
And you can hear the organ call, but they're not what they want.
Six grandchildren.
Is the meeting, is it closed, the meeting yet?
Staying for the week.
No, not yet?
I'm staying for the week, okay. Adjourned? Motion by Rick, seconded by Nancy to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Rick and Nancy.
Nancy, early. So we're having.